Hi, everybody. I'm Eric Allgood. Welcome to another edition of Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com. Tony Chapman joins us in Grand Island as his usual. We are on location in hashtag in our office this year, so we're not in anywhere fancy. We're down to basics. We're down to the business of getting ready for the high school football playoffs. We're getting ready for the postseason for volleyball, which is rapidly approaching. Fun times for us here. Softball is in the books, of course. Some great runs at state cross country last week from some of our Strive schools. We'll highlight some of those in our Strive Stars. The football brackets are out. We're going to talk at length about them later on in the show. Tony, Thanksgiving is a month away. Halloween is coming up, but is this the fun time of the year?
It is, exactly, Eric. We got our pumpkins carved at the Chapman House tonight before the show, so we are ready for the home stretch, and it's going to be, you know, 3 games a week, volleyball up through state. We'll probably be watching, and then state finals and 8-man semifinals will hit us after state volleyball. It'll be wild and crazy until Thanksgiving time. You're exactly right.
We always love interacting on the show, so don't make sure you use the hashtag Prep Huddle Live. Interact with us throughout the show. If you've got a question or a comment, we'd love to get to that throughout the day. Speaking of the show itself, goodness gracious, Tony, we have got far and away, I think, our biggest, well, definitely our biggest lineup of the year. Talk about that for us.
Well, Burke Brown's going to join us in a minute. He's standing by at the Metro Conference Volleyball Tournament right now. We'll get into the 8-man playoffs with Jim Clarkson from Clarkson Lee. The Patriots are hosting Diller Odell. Tomorrow night, they're a 7 seed in the D1 East bracket. And then my favorite, we're going to have Nate Klaus on from Rivals.com, and he'll talk to us about some of the top products in the state that we'll see in the 11-man playoffs on Friday night. And then we will go down to Wilbur and talk to Wolverine head coach Lynn Juergens. The Wilbur Claytonia is undefeated, and they will host defending state champion Boone Central on Friday night. So it'll be fun, and the Truck Center Company's hotline will be burning up tonight. It should be a good time.
Speaking of Truck Center Companies, if you haven't been on StriveSports.com before just watching our show, go back to the homepage on Strive Sports and find the fantastic article that Tony wrote. He considers himself a hack. I'm not sure why, because it is a fantastic article about Truck Center Companies and a couple of not necessarily Strive alum, but Nebraska alums, Chad and Chris Kelsey, of course, originally from Auburn, played football at Nebraska, on to bigger and better things on the football field. But what a wonderful story about them coming home and what they have learned from football. And Tony did a fantastic job with that article. So make sure you check that out with the Kelsey boys. It's hard to miss them on the cover picture of their article, by the way. So with that, let's get into our show. Our first guest tonight is our always esteemed colleague, Burke Brown of NebraskaPrepVolleyball.com. Burke, thanks for joining us again. I know, if I'm not mistaken, you're out in the action, as it were, right now. Are you not?
Well, I was, sometimes you get lucky, and the action has actually just wrapped up, so I've been able to find a little place of solitude so I could be fully invested here. But I just want to real quick, you hit the nail on the head. Great article. I loved reading it earlier today that Tony did on the Kelseys. And I've got to say, that's what I love about being in Nebraska, man. I mean, two great guys, great athletes, and they come back, you know, just stuff here. That's what it's all about. And so I would highly recommend people as well. In case you didn't do a good enough job selling it, Eric, great article. I mean, that's, to me, what Nebraska is all about, sports.
Tony's smiling bright in Grand Island right now. So, Burke, let's talk some volleyball. Hot teams heading into districts, of course. That will start next week. The brackets for districts will be coming out tomorrow, I believe. Who are some of those teams that are going to keep your attention very hotly through that district play?
Well, I think that one thing that we really learned last year and really holds true, I think, in just about any sport is at this time of the year, about the only things that die harder than cockroaches are senior dominated teams and defending champions. And when you start talking about playoff brackets and district tournaments, those always just seem to be the teams that just refuse to die and go away. And so when you talk about hot teams, I think one team that's going to be incredibly fun to watch right now is Omaha Scott. They are on fire. They're just dominating people in Class B. you know, they had an incredible year last year and then just came up short in the state championship to Norris. But they look like a team that is on an absolute mission right now. They're going to be fun to watch. And I tell you what, other hot teams, Johnson Brock right now in Class D1 is red hot. They just won the Pioneer Conference with big wins over Falls City Sacred Heart, Diller Odell. We've talked at length before about Hampton. I know that they ran into a little bit of a buzzsaw with Exeter Milligan in the Crossroads Final, but that's a team that's been hot this last 7-8 weeks. Sutton has had some really, really nice wins, and Adam Kuntz does an incredible job there. Great coach. They've got 3 wins over Sandy Creek. They beat teams like Friend, Bishop Newman, Heartland, and won the Southern Nebraska Conference. So they're on a roll. Donovan Trumbull is another team on an absolute roll right now, having a great year. They've just swept Centura, which is a great team. They've got a 3-2 win over St. Paul. And then, to me, one of the big stories to watch is Sandhills Bedford. They're the only undefeated team left in the state right now at 29-0. It'll be interesting to see. They maybe haven't played the competition some other Class D2 teams have. But still, nonetheless, it's always interesting when you get into the postseason and you've still got an undefeated team left.
Hey, Burke, I wanted to quickly talk to you about the Metro Conference tournament real quick. As I'm looking and we saw your projected Class A districts earlier today on Twitter, it looks like you've got four of the top 7 seeds or 4 of the district hosts that are in the Metro Conference tournament right now. Is that playing out as expected? I know Mary and Papillion La Vista are playing very well. How has the Metro Conference tournament played out so far?
You know what? It's been pretty much all chalk throughout. Now, I mean, obviously there's some seedings where, mild upsets where we had number 9 Westside advance over number 8 Omaha Central. But for the most part, it's been chalk and it's been straight set wins by the top seeds. Omaha Marion is, you talk about a team, 2-time defending state champion, loaded with seniors. They're another team that seems to be on a mission. And they actually just a little bit ago swept Millard West in the semifinals, and they'll face Papillion La Vista, rematch last year's Metro Conference final. Papillion La Vista swept Papillion La Vista South, and so both those teams should be there, possibly maybe a preview as a state championship match. Not that you can count North Platte out. They'll be very tough as well, but the state champion for many, many years in a row now has come out of the Metro Conference. And so, I think tomorrow night's championship match between Marion and Papillion La Vista will tell us if there's anybody who can really challenge Marion right now for that Class A state title outside of North Platte. I think North Platte can give them troubles. But if there's going to be anybody else from Omaha or Lincoln that can do it, I got a feeling it's going to be Papillion.
Burke, as we get ready for sub-district play and some sub-state play and then into the state, what's a team or two that we might want to keep an eye on outside of the favorites that might be a dark horse that finds something in the next week or so and can get on that hot roll and maybe has the manageable type bracket and district to get to state?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. I think in Class A, I think one of the dark horses there is Bellevue West. It's always interesting. They'll get Lincoln Southwest. Lincoln Southwest is a great team. But it's always interesting when you get, again, a school like Bellevue West, a lot of seniors. Lincoln Southwest would probably be in position if they were to lose. They'd get a wild card, so maybe not the pressure. So I think Class A, at least, Bellevue West is a team that you have to look at as a possible dark horse. They're very athletic, very scrappy group. I also think Gothenburg is another team that's been playing really well. Now, they don't have the easiest road. They've got Ogallala in their sub-district, and you don't want to try to make a living knocking off Steve Morgan teams. But they're a team that could potentially jump up, win, in a one-match situation against Ogallala and find themselves into the state tournament. They've had an outstanding season, and that wouldn't surprise me at all either. And then I think maybe even Donovan Trumbull, we talked about them a little bit, but as well as they're playing. They're a team that could be under the radar in C2 that could pull a couple upsets and find themselves at state coming out of a very, very difficult sub-district.
That is Burke Brown with NebraskaPrepVolleyball.com on the Truck Center Company's hotline. Burke, we're going to cut you off just a little bit. I know we could talk about this for the rest of the night, but knowing that we've got a heavy workload with some B districts next week on Wednesday and some A on Thursday, then next week should prove to be a huge volleyball show, so we're looking forward to that. Thanks for joining us tonight.
My pleasure. I'm looking forward to listening to the rest of the show.
All right. Great night, guys. Hey, thanks, Burke. All right, Tony, it's time to revisit some of the best performances across the state in a wide variety of sports. We call it the Strive Stars, so please tell us who shined brightest last week.
Yeah, let's start with our Channel C Game of the Week in Aurora, and we're going to recognize, we're recognizing probably a few more than five this week, Eric, but that's fine. We got five bullet points that we'll run down really quick. So we'll start in Aurora with Preston Dibbern and Kyle Schmidt from the Huskies. Preston ran 30 times for 177 yards. He had touchdown runs of 66. And 6 yards in the win over York 38-35. I didn't screw it up that time. Kyle Schmidt had kind of the game, one of the game-changing plays. Aurora's up 12-0, and they York is going in about their own 30 or on their 30-yard line, and Kyle Schmidt with a 70-yard pick six that gave Aurora an 18-0 lead about midway through the second quarter.
I want to pause you real quick, Tony.
Sure.
Because it wasn't until I went back and was working on the highlight video with JC today that I realized that not only did Kyle have the pick six, Kyle had the first fumble recovery that York had coughed it up deep in their end zone, and that, I believe, led to an Aurora score. So Kyle had two early turnovers. One he took back for the touchdown. So not just the interception, which didn't make the highlight plays, but the fumble recovery as well.
Well, and he does a great job on, you know, a kind of a 3-4 scheme, and he's kind of an inside linebacker in there for Coach Peterson, and he plays tight end, but they don't throw it to him much. He's a glorified, I think, offensive tackle on the offensive side of the ball with their big guys up front. So, but he is a very, very nice player for the Huskies. So number four, we're going to go out to Kearney, and we'll first recognize the Millard West and Cozad cross country girls teams. They both were state runner up in the first two girls races of the meet there at Kearney Country Club. Number three, we're going to go to Sutton and to Johnson Brock. So in Sutton, we had McKenna Grease, who was Burke Brown and Nebraska Prep Volleyball's Class C2 Player of the Week. And then in D1, we had another one in Fallon Studheit at Johnson Brock. Burke mentioned that the Eagles got the championship of the Pioneer Conference with wins over Diller Odell and Fall City Sacred Heart last week. So they are both Sutton and Johnson Brock primed and ready for district play as that heats up next week. Number two, we'll recognize our team state cross country champions, and those were the Millard West boys and the Milford boys for the fourth year in a row. And then also at Boone Central Newman Grove, their girls team edged Cozad for the state title in the Class C race. So a great job by our teams there at Kearney Country Club, and a really successful meet there. And then we'll finish still in Kearney. We'll recognize our individual champions, both boys in the Class A race, Seth Hirsch from Millard West, who lost to no one from Nebraska this year. His only time he didn't finish first was he finished fourth at the Roy Grayak Invitational in Minneapolis earlier this year. And then Ty Masco from Milford, who finished his career as a four-time state champion for the Eagles, as the Eagles also won the team race. It was a great week last week for our kids, and some great football games, some great volleyball games, and capped off with a really nice day at the state cross country meet. I know, Eric, you were there to see it for the first time in a while, which was fun.
First time for me to be in Kearney for the state cross country meet since I was in high school to watch some of my friends. So that was a lot of fun. I do not remember that golf course being that hilly, though. So next year I'm getting a golf cart like some of those other guys. That will be a lot of fun. Big thank you to Cornerstone Bank, Dickey's Barbecue in York, Truck Center Companies, and Channel Seed for sponsoring our show. Stay tuned, because there is lots more coming up on Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com.
I never really imagined that I would be a diesel technician. I started out in a whole different other field, and then kind of worked my way and stumbled my way into it, and I enjoy every day of it.
The people that I work with are great. Even if you're having a bad day, you know, they find some way to try to make you laugh or smile, to try to brighten your day up. It'd be a life-changing opportunity. So there's a lot of good things that this company has to offer.
Yeah, I get it. For the little things. Technology's great. It makes things easier. It's faster. We can get things done wherever we go. And we get all that from our bank. It works for us. But for the bigger things, the things that really count, I still want to talk to the people I know and trust. That's why I'm here.
Home-cooked favorites and online ordering so you can skip the line. That's what you'll find at Dickey's Barbecue in York. Log on to dickeys.com, select the York address, sign in or create a profile, and you'll be ordering delicious barbecue in just seconds. Choose from a variety of meats like brisket, pulled pork, chicken breast, or sausage. Add a home-style side like waffle iron fries, fried onion tanglers, barbecue beans, and even fried okra. You won't go away hungry. Try Dickey's Barbecue today and log on to dickeys.com. Kids eat free on Sundays. Seedsmanship is what truly sets Channel Seed apart from other seed brands. It's our unmatched ability to provide you with the expert advice and customized service that helps you get the most yield out of your acres. It's the added value of year-round service combined with elite seed products that you only get from Channel Seed. At Channel, we know the importance of staying connected. As seed experts, we look to get the most out of your fields by putting ourselves in them throughout the season. That's seedsmanship at work.
All right.
Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com. Thanks for joining us. The football playoffs begin tomorrow with the six-man and eight-man ranks. The 11-man ranks will begin their playoff journeys on Friday. And we are joined by Clarkson Lee head coach Jim Clarkson on the Truck Center Company's hotline. Coach, first of all, thanks for taking time. I understand you're multitasking between Survivor and the baseball game and watching our show. You're a busy guy tonight.
Yeah, trying to keep everything, keep my mind off the game, I guess, a little bit.
There you go. Obviously, a big congratulations on your season that you've had so far. Talk about how far this team has come since the beginning of fall camp. I know the change in players mentally and physically, it's always a great change through the year. But where have you seen maybe the most growth for these guys?
I think mentally. You know, our biggest concern was going into the year was just going to be our team mental toughness overall. You know, last year we thought we had a decent team, and but we kind of lost some games that, you know, could have went either way, and I wasn't sure if we had really gotten over that hump or not. So I've been really impressed about how our kids have handled week to week. You know, we did have one little minor letdown against Humphrey Lindsay earlier in the year, but other than that, we've approached every game with a pretty good mental toughness, and it's worked out well for us.
Coach, I wanted to talk to you about the rigors of your schedule. I think probably you would maybe hopefully agree that you might play in one of the toughest districts in the state. You obviously were the champions of that district this year, but Howells Dodge is in there. Fullerton is in there. And then Humphrey, Lindsay Holy Family, and Nebraska Christian are two teams that are not eligible for the playoffs, but would have been had they had the right enrollment numbers. So talk about your district and how that's prepared you for the second season, I guess.
Yeah, you know, up in this area, it seems like year in and year out, every 2 years, we get a new schedule, and it always seems to be pretty tough. And all those teams you just mentioned all have great traditions, and they have great players and a lot of physical football up here. So that's probably helped us the most. Is, you know, we have to play a pretty physical brand of football just to survive week to week. And when you get a chance to play in our playoff game, and then some guys come from another part of the state, you know, we like to pride ourselves in the Highway 91 you know, a tradition, and that usually helps us out a little bit playing some of these other opponents.
Coach, I've heard other coaches, and Tony just did as well right there, talk about how the playoffs begin the second season. At the same time, there's so much riding on seemingly every play. As you get ready for a game in the playoffs, and then especially once you're into the game itself, how do you try to keep the team level throughout the week and the day of the game and during the game itself and try not to ride that roller coaster of emotions?
Well, you know, we try to just keep it business as usual. You know, we did try and lay to rest the regular season, and we talked about the second season, as you mentioned. But But outside of that, you know, our practices and everything, we try and keep the schedule status quo as much as we can. You know, I know there'll be some weekend practices sometimes when you get into the playoffs or whatever, but for the most part, you know, we try and keep everything the same and treat everything exactly the same way as we have all year, and hopefully that kind of keeps your kids somewhat grounded.
Coach, maybe a two-part question here. I'll ask you the first part, and then we'll go into the second. But last week you played a Nebraska Christian team who's not eligible for the playoffs, who was 6-1, and that was probably, I'm sure you felt like, their playoff game, one they wanted to end on a high note. Your guys played a really good game. You get a nice win against them. How much do you feel like that can carry into the playoffs for your team?
Well, I think that was pretty huge. You know, like you said, Nebraska Christians, they're a very good football team, and they're very well coached. And they came up here, and our kids really answered the bell. You know, I was a little bit nervous. I wasn't sure, you know, if our kids would be able to do that. But, you know, it was our homecoming game, and a district title was on the line. And I think I was talking to you guys last year when I realized we didn't win one district game last year. So to come back and become a district champs this year was pretty special, I thought, for our kids. And just, you know, just to play for a championship, you know, it was a good cherry on top for our regular season.
Yeah, Coach, you've got you had a great little running back, slot back guy in Chris Konacek last year, who we had a lot of fun with at the 8-man All-Star game. This year it's Brad Bunner, who's done a great job for you guys at tailback, and we watched him run at state track. So I know it's kind of a spoil of riches, as they say, but you got a nice line in front of him. Can you talk about how your offense has played, specifically Brad in the line, and how that has gone for you this year?
Well, you know, we really had high expectations for Bradley. He didn't play a lot of offense last year because Konacek hogged all the carries, I guess, from him. But yeah, Brent Bunner, he's a special kid. You know, he's very physical. He's very, very fast. As he says, he was in the state track meet and did quite well down there. He's different, though. He's a, you know, Chris Konacek was a, you know, he's a playmaker. He would do all sorts of fancy athletic things. Brad, he puts his foot in the ground. He gets downhill in a hurry. So he's a very physical kid. You know, he's not going to really necessarily juke yet. He's going to get the tough yards. And then, so that's been a really nice thing for us, you know, coming back from that. It's just kind of a different, little different vibe for our team. But like you said, our big guys up front have been doing a fantastic job. They seem to get better every week up front, and they're doing a great job. It's opening some holes and really, really progressed throughout the season. And also, I've got to have to mention Kobe Proposki, our quarterback, has done a great job, too. He's almost at 1,000 yards as well. So he's been a nice compliment to Brad there.
Coach, the playoffs obviously loom large. Diller Odell is the opponent coming up tomorrow. So what are some of the keys to beating the Griffins?
You know, it's kind of standard coach speak, but, you know, for us, we need to finish off drives, first of all. We know if we get a good drive going, we need to finish. You know, that's always a key. We need to get points when they're available. And on defense, we need to stop their run. You know, they have a nice little run game. They have a good-looking quarterback down there. So if we can stop their run and make them start throwing the ball around, even though they do have a pretty nice pass game as well, we figure if we can make them one-dimensional, that'll really help us out.
Hey, Coach, this is Taylor. Just wanted to – Tony mentioned the 8-man All-Star game. Wanted to just thank you for – you kind of were the one that lined all that up for us last summer, so I want to thank you for that.
I'm glad it worked out. I had no idea how it all worked out. I had no idea you guys would do such a fantastic job with it either. But I can say I know my wife was at home. I was at the game, but my wife was home, and she watched your guys' production and gave you guys rave reviews. So,
all right.
But you impressed her, so I guess, hey, that's hard to do. I can't even do that.
Hey, I always say that if we can impress anybody's wife, we are doing a fantastic job. That is Jim Clarkson of Clarkson Lee. Thanks so much for taking time. And best of luck to you and the guys tomorrow night and through the rest of the playoffs.
Well, thank you guys, man. You guys do a great job. We really appreciate what you do. And go Pats. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. All right, Tony, it's Channel Seed Game of the Week time. We can revisit a game that we had last Friday when Aurora played host to York. It was we had it circled from before week one. It was a great game last year in York, this year in Aurora. We were treated to an instant classic again last week. So let's go back to the highlights from the Aurora and York game from last Friday. It's the Channel Seed Game of the Week. York kicking to Aurora. This will be fielded on the near side at about the 8-yard line. That looks like Dibbern across the 20, 25, got a hole. 35, 40, wrangled down from behind across the 40-yard line to about the 43, and actually had to hesitate just a little bit. And then with the power toss and just powering through, and the ball came out, and Aurora's got the football. Coffin with the carry And coming up with it for Aurora looked like Kyle Schmidt, one of the inside linebackers. Fake the jet sweep, fake the handoff. Fox rolling to his right. Has some time, fires it into the end zone. It is caught. Touchdown. Not a great snap. Aurora comes after it. The Huskies have blocked it. Bolton into the end zone. Touchdown. Late shift. And they want a pop pass. And now Califf will roll. He's got pressure. Spins away from one. Flips it forward. It's picked off. It's picked off. The Huskies have got it. Down the near sideline. Going with it. Cutting back to the inside. At the 10. Tripped. No. Into the end zone. Touchdown. Kyle Schmidt. Fox under center. Toss sweep. Dibbert. Cutting back in. Sliding. Into the end zone. Touchdown. Huskies. Three receivers in a bunch to the right. One all the way out by himself in the left. And now they will throw the deep pass, and it is over the middle. It is caught, and it's going to be gone for the touchdown. Nick Pettigrove on 3rd and 12 will take it 63 yards for the score. And I don't think the Huskies have to even snap it, and that is, in fact, exactly what the case is going to be. Kyle Peterson is saying, you know what, we will take 24-0, 24-7, I should say, and we will go to the halftime break. Looking the right the whole way. Little back door or back shoulder pass, and it is intercepted. Picked off by Todd Honus. And it's Dibbert trying the left side. He's got a block on the edge. 45, 50, foot race near sideline. There goes Preston Dibbert. 10, 5, touchdown, Huskies. Now an empty set for York. And this is Schultz right up the gut. There goes JJ. Touchdown, Dukes. Everybody else up for the York defense. Play action. Fox rolls right, sets up, fires it deep. Honus is out there, adjusts. He makes the catch. Inside the 10, down to the 6-yard line. First and goal, Huskies. Toss sweep, Dibbert, left side. Going forward, powers it, got it, touchdown. All right, so we're back. It is 3rd and 9 for Aurora from their own 7-yard line. Fox over the middle, and it is picked off. It is picked off by Jackson Coffin, coming to the near side, and he will return it down inside the 5 at the 4-yard line. And the toss to Kowalski right side, and he walks into the end zone. Onside kick near side, and it's loose again, and the Dukes, I think, have got another onside kick. They do. They will give it right side, and it's Kowalski on the score. 4-yard touchdown run by Alex Kowalski. Oh, I do see Schultz. He was hiding. Now he's in the slot. Takes off down the field. Califf looking. Now fires it over the middle. It is caught. That's Roney. He's got a block. He's got down the near sideline. And Roney is going to score all the way for the Dukes. There are no flags on the field. That is 67 yards. Holy cow. What's happening in Aurora? York with a shift over. Now Luther will get this kick. It is rolling, and did York touch it before the 10? Boy, it sure looked like that, but we're a lot farther away than the officials are. Nobody's really jumping on either side, and now the Huskies say, we're going to get the football, and they will. What a crazy end to this game. Fox will take it, take the kneel down, and that will be your ball game. The Aurora Huskies, 9-0 in the regular season. And they will have one of the top spots in the Class B playoffs. The York Dukes will be 8-1 in the regular season. Ah, a lot of respect out there. Gavin Rush, Marvin Lazo, sharing an embrace. Those guys battled hard all night. But what a game from these two. And perhaps a playoff meeting still coming up in their future, but what a fantastic game here tonight. Final count, Aurora 38, York 35. Thanks for tuning in on the Aurora Strive channel for our Channel Seed Game of the Week.
We want to say again a big thank you to the Aurora Strive crew that let us come in and broadcast with the Game of the Week, and of course it's presented by Channel Seed. Now we can move on to an exciting new feature here on Prep Huddle Live tonight. We are happy to be joined by Nate Klaus, Rivals.com and HuskerOnline.com recruiting analyst. Nate, thanks for taking some time with us tonight.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on.
All right, Nate, we'll kind of get right to it here. We want to start with maybe some of our schools that will be in the playoffs. I don't know if you've had a chance to watch Millard West, number one in Class A, and in a Strive school that we have seen play a couple times, but solid on the offensive and defensive line, and probably the name that most people know from you guys having followed is the South Dakota State commit, Jack Domandel. Can you talk about Jack and what he'll take with him to Brookings as far as his play goes?
Absolutely. You know, I've been able to catch Millard West a couple times this year. And, you know, one thing you always know that you're going to get with Coach Peterson's team is good line play. And Jack Domandel's, you know, pretty much been the anchor of that offensive line now for the past few years, played a lot of good football for the Wildcats. And, I mean, when you just off the hoof, you know, he's 6'4", 285 pounds. He's extremely strong, athletic guy. But I think maybe the thing that stands out the most about him is that he's a true center prospect. You don't see too many guys, you know, kind of grow up playing the center position from, you know, the beginning of their high school career through the end. And I think that's, you know, what a lot of coaches kind of liked about him is that they're able to see him play center instead of trying to project a guy to that position. You know, and then you watch him play and he's a technician. You can tell he's been extremely well coached. He's extremely strong, and I mean, he's nasty too. He's a competitor. He likes to mix it up a little bit. So, you know, it has all the great qualities that you'd look for out of an offensive lineman. I think he's going to have a great career at South Dakota State.
Nate, who are some of the other top players in Class A who maybe haven't committed yet, who might be some of the top prospects you see, not just for this year, but even for 2017?
Yeah, I mean, I think when you look at the players that are still out there for 2016, one of, you know, probably the first guy that comes to mind is Cade Johnson at Bellevue West. You know, playing for an undefeated team, obviously Bellevue West puts up ridiculous stats, and Cade Johnson is, you know, right there kind of leading the way. I know he's got over 700 receiving yards this year, like 12 touchdowns, and he plays defense too. You know, he's kind of been a shutdown corner when they've needed that guy. I think he's got like 5 interceptions. So he's probably one of the better athletes right now that's uncommitted. Jacob Matthew, you know, kind of the linebacker, defensive end, fullback type out of Millard North is another one. Monte McGarry, I think, is an undervalued athlete in the metro area out of Omaha South. A wide receiver, cornerback, you know, very good athlete. He's got a couple offers. Northern Iowa is probably his biggest offer at the time. And then you look at some of the underclassmen, and back to Bellevue West, you know, Tyler Charay, a big 6'4", 285-pound offensive lineman there, you know, big-time wrestler too. Again, a kid who's just tough as nails, been starting on the offensive line since his freshman year. You know, and he's getting a lot of attention. I was at the Nebraska game this past weekend as a recruit. So, you know, and he's hearing from a lot of Big 12, Big 10 schools at this time. And, you know, Jalen Bradley, the running back at Bellevue West, is another interesting prospect who, you know, I think when you think of Bellevue West, you think that they're throwing it all over the yard, which they do. But Jalen Bradley's quietly rushed for over 1,000 yards this year. You know, and averages right around 10 yards per carry. I was able to catch him play last week against Omaha Central, and he was extremely impressive. You know, maybe one of the most intriguing underclassmen in Class A is Cordarius Bailey out of Lincoln High, 6'4", 215-pound defensive end. You know, originally from Mississippi, moved to Lincoln his freshman year, and I'll tell you what, he's an exciting prospect to watch. And he just seems to get better each and every game. And he's going to be a guy that really garners a lot of attention, you know, moving forward.
Wow, Nate Klaus does his homework. This is awesome. Nate, I wanted to get down to Class B with you real quick. We kind of started chatting earlier this week about the big tight end, Austin Allen from Aurora. You know, he's a 6'8", 240-pound kid, outside linebacker, defensive end kind of guy in the 3-4, and then I think just impossible to guard as a tight end. And I was impressed. We saw him the first week of the year against Crete, and then we saw him last week against York, and his skill set has improved greatly over the past year. Is this a kid who might attract some Power 5 type offers as a tight end or an outside linebacker?
There's no question in my mind. After being able to see his season highlights, there's no doubt in my mind that he's going to get a lot of attention and Power 5 attention. You know, Nebraska is the only team that's really reached out and contacted him so far, but they certainly won't be the last. And I mean, you just can't, you can't coach 6'8", you know, 220, 240 pound, you know, size. And then you watch him out in the field, and he's not just a big, tall guy out there. I mean, he's an athlete. You don't see too many guys, you know, that size, that can move the way he does. You know, generally you have a, you know, a kid like that playing on the line, and he's out there playing outside linebacker, operating in space, you know, dropping in coverage and just using his length on defense to pick passes off and make tackles. And then on offense, how do you cover 6'8" that can jump? I mean, he's just a complete mismatch on both sides of the ball. And, you know, I think that, I think there's, like I said, no question he's going to get a lot of interest. And, you know, I think some Power Five teams would be dumb not to really consider offering this kid early, because, as you said, he just seems to get better and better. And I think he's going to continue to grow into that big frame of his and become even more of a better, you know, better athlete going forward.
I want to stick with the Huskies real quick. I'm going to go off script, but Craig Bull got a good one in Gavin Rush, I think. I stand next to him, and he's probably all a 6'4", maybe closer to 6'5", and I would say 270 to 280 pounds, and he's one of those guys, I think, too, has a little mean streak in him. Can you talk about Gavin and what he'll take to Wyoming?
Yeah, he definitely has got that mean streak. And, you know, when you're looking for an interior offensive lineman that can just move bodies, you're wanting a guy like Gavin Rush, just a nasty hog molly up there in that interior line. And I think that's what, you know, Wyoming, that's why they like him so much. He plays with an edge, and he's going to be a guy, you know, he's a hardworking kid. He lives in the weight room. You know, he's a good in the classroom, too. He's very smart. And he's just your classic kind of throwback offensive lineman. And, you know, I think you know, if Nebraska weren't so deep on the interior line, you know, I think that we may have seen them offer the two guys that we've talked about tonight, Jack Domandel and Gavin Rush. You know, the Huskers have recruited the interior line very well the past couple years. And, you know, and I think that kind of, you know, made numbers a little bit limited for this year's class. But I tell you what, Craig Bowl is getting a good one in Gavin Rush.
Let's jump ahead to maybe 2018. I want to stay in Class B, but Moses Bryant at Elkhorn South appears to be, to me, one of the most talked about running backs in Nebraska prep in a long time. You probably have to go back to Amon Green for a back who's been talked about from this state. He was a 1,000-yard rusher as a freshman. He's over that again this year as a sophomore, and the Storm is undefeated. And I don't know about you, but, man, them, and I'd like to see him play York maybe in the second week and all the way in the finals if they could get to Aurora. I mean, I'd like to see this kid play. Can you talk about Moses, what it would mean for the Nebraska program to keep him inside our border?
Yeah, Moses Bryant, he's a special talent. Like you said, 1,000-yard rusher as a freshman. And I don't know the stats right off the top of my head, but I do know that doesn't happen very often. And what's impressive this year is he didn't catch anyone by surprise this year, and he's still been able to put up great numbers. And he's put up those numbers while only playing, you know, the first half of the most of the games, you know, this year. So because they've scored so much, but he's a tremendous athlete. And I think he could project as a running back, a wide receiver, or even a corner at the next level. And there's no doubt in my mind he's a kid that's going to be getting an offer from Nebraska. I don't know exactly when that will happen, but it's going to happen sooner than later. And definitely, you know, an athlete that Nebraska needs to keep in state. You know, since Mike Riley's come on board, you know, I think they've tried to make it a point to give in-state kids more attention, to recruit these guys harder, not, you know, wait around to offer. And we've seen that with Cameron Jurgens out of Beatrice, how they offered him early and he jumped on that. And I think Moses Bryant will be that next prospect in the 2018 class to gain the Nebraska offer. And that could very well happen, you know, after the playoffs are over. And hopefully, like you said, that state championship game against Aurora, I think that would be a tremendous matchup.
Oh, we don't want to get that far now. We'll talk about that later on in the few weeks. Now, Nate, you can't be jumping too far ahead of us. But I do want to take you to Class C. It seems like the small classes in Nebraska have historically produced some good names that not just Nebraska, but some of our other surrounding schools are definitely keeping a close eye on. Obviously, David Engelhop from Norfolk Catholic is a Wyoming commit. Any other prospects from the Class C ranks? Ben Still, Ashland Greenwood is a name that a lot of people know, but are there other prospects that we need to keep an eye on in some of those smaller classes?
Absolutely. You know, and what a year Engelhop and Stilley have had. You know, and keep an eye on Engelhop. I wouldn't be surprised if Nebraska comes back around later on in the year and maybe tries to pull him away from Craig Bull. But, yeah, there are definitely some other names in that class and a lot of underclassmen, to be honest with you. When you talk about quarterback Noah Vedral out of Wahoo Bishop Newman, he's a kid who's going to be gaining a lot of attention and I think is, you know, putting some good game film, some good tape together this season for recruiters to look at. Jordan Powell from Central City, the defensive end, there, 6'3", 230-pound kid who's just picked up a South Dakota State offer just this past week and has really had a tremendous season, you know, on the defensive side of the ball for Central City. Trevor Nicholson, the running back out of Ashland Greenwood. You know, I think if he's not leading the state in rushing, he's right there, probably second. And he's just a workhorse. You know, he's kind of a throwback, tough runner, state champion wrestler. I mean, there's a lot to like about that kid, and he's going to be gaining a lot of attention as well. You know, the good thing about the playoffs is it seems like there's always a couple kids that kind of emerge at this time of the year and really, you know, take their games to the next level. And I wouldn't be surprised if there's more names that come out of that C1 class as the playoffs progress.
Well, this has been a lot of fun, Nate. Nate Klaus from Rivals.com and HuskerOnline.com, recruiting analyst. I have a feeling that we may have to get you on the phone line, get a little closer to February or so, if that works. Nate, it's been fantastic talking with you tonight. Some outstanding insights and some good names to keep in mind. Thanks a lot, man.
Hey, no problem. Happy to be on with you guys.
All right, with that, I think we've got another commercial break coming up, and we've got plenty more in the show. Talk a lot about the football playoffs. That's coming up next on Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com.
I love it. It's fun. It's a fun industry to be in. Meet lots of different people, do lots of different stuff. There's always something new happening, so.
So far, I've been enjoying it since I've been here. It's been great learning new stuff every day. I recommend anyone come in and work here because so far the working environment's friendly, everyone's kind, and also the new guys that come here, they will gain the confidence that they need just to come and work.
I like how everybody around here is, you know, we all kind of become real good friends. It's like a second family here. It's not something you'd come to just work for a month or two. It's something you'll want to stick with forever.
Favorites and online ordering so you can skip the line. That's what you'll find at Dickey's Barbecue in York. Log on to dickeys.com, select the York address, sign in or create a profile, and you'll be ordering delicious barbecue in just seconds. Choose from a variety of meats like brisket, pulled pork, chicken breast, or sausage. Add a homestyle side like waffle iron fries, fried onion tanglers, barbecue beans, and even fried okra. You won't go away hungry. Try Dickey's Barbecue today and log on to dickeys.com. Kids eat free on Sundays. Seedsmanship is what truly sets Channel Seed apart from other seed brands. It's our unmatched ability to provide you with the expert advice and customized service that helps you get the most yield out of your acres. It's the added value of year-round service combined with elite seed products that you only get from Channel Seed. At Channel, we know the importance of staying connected. As seed experts, we look to get the most out of your fields by putting ourselves in them throughout the season. That's seedsmanship at work.
Yeah, I get it. For the little things. Technology's great. It makes things easier. It's faster. We can get things done wherever we go. And we get all that from our bank. It works for us. But for the bigger things, the things that really count, I still want to talk to the people I know and trust. That's why I'm here.
Welcome back to Prep Auto Live on StriveSports.com. I'm Eric Allgood. Tony Chapman joins us in Grand Island. And now with the football playoffs, of course, beginning tomorrow and Friday, also for the 11-man and the 6-man. We had to go check. Yes, 6-man on Friday along with the 11-man. We are going to dive into the 11-man ranks. And we've got Wilbur Claytonia head coach Lynn Juergens on the Truck Center Company hotline. Coach, thanks a lot for taking some time on a Wednesday night.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's great.
This is obviously a familiar place for you and your Wolverines to be, undefeated on the season, district champions with the playoff looming, obviously. Your team has played very well this year. That kind of goes without saying, just like last year. How far have these guys and this team come from the end of last season to this point this year?
Well, this is a whole new group of guys. We had 17 seniors that graduated last year. So these are a whole new group of guys. A couple of them played last year quite a bit. But, you know, for the most part, we're a new team, but, you know, we've got a program in place where kids step up, and they know what their role is, and we've been fortunate that way that we've been able to win. And, you know, we had a nice season, but we need to do some in the playoffs.
Coach, introduce us to your team and talk about maybe a few players who have had nice seasons for you and just that have maybe kind of led your team so far.
Okay, our quarterback, Connor O'Toole, he's a two-year starter. He's a tremendous athlete. He's a great dual threat quarterback. He can run, he can throw. He's a great leader for us. Fullback, we got Jalen Graham. He's a senior. He's a new kid. He kind of transferred from Lincoln East, which is a great addition for us. He's a 6-foot, 240-pound fullback, so it's nice to have that. And then Derek DeHouse, he's a high back for us and just a rock-solid player. Doesn't make any mistakes. Up front, we're very tough. We got some big boys. We got Austin Heifle, our left tackle. He's a senior. And then left guard, we got Dustin Yelinek, a junior. Our center's Riley Amolka. He's also a junior. Right guard is Zach Keller, a junior. And then right tackle is Gavin Oliver, another junior. And those guys have been tremendous this year. We got, you know, they're not only big and athletic, but they're really smart, and that makes a coach look pretty good sometimes. So it's nice to have those guys on our side. Our tight end's Jacob Ullman. He's a junior. And then we've got our split end, the senior Matt Petroschek, and our wing back, the senior Matt Tenapier. And that's our offense. Defensively.
I was just going to say, talk about your defense. I believe second in the class in scoring defense. You've kind of leaned on them. This year, I think.
Yeah, some of that's our schedule hasn't been the toughest, but a lot of that is we're pretty solid on defense, and the big thing is we play team football, and our kids do their jobs, and, you know, nobody's out there to be a superstar, and they don't care who's making the tackles or who's getting the touchdowns or the yards. They just want to win, and that's just a great thing, and that's a big credit to our kids. But defensively, yeah, we go a lot of the same guys. Jalen Graham starts a defensive end, and then we got Riley Amolka and Zach Keller are D tackles. Nose guard is Nathan Thompson. He's a junior. And then our other end is Jacob Ullman. We play a 53 typically if we can. Our linebackers go O'Toole, Towski, and Yelinek. And then our DBs, we got a couple of juniors, Bryce Brush and Tanner Sand, and then Matt Petroschek also.
Coach, what have you seen from the Cardinals on film? Obviously, the defending state champs, a new coach, and Mark Hudson, who was at Ravenna for many years. They've only lost to Norfolk Catholic and Columbus SCOTUS bookend losses with 7 straight wins in between. What have you seen from the Cardinals, and what are the kind of maybe some of the things you need to stop and need to do offensively against them on Friday night?
Yeah, I'll be honest, it's a really tough draw for us. Being a 4-seed and undefeated, you'd hope to get somebody that's not quite as tough as these guys are. But, you know, they're a tremendous football team. They're huge up front. They got athletes all over the field. They can run it. They can throw it. They're very balanced. I think they lead the state in total offense. But you know what? They got to come to our place, and we're going to be ready to go. They just have a heck of a program up there, and they're very tough. I know we got a tremendous challenge in front of us. You know, I think it'll be a good football game. We've got to take care of the ball and not beat ourselves. We've got to make them earn everything they get, and then we've got to score points offensively because we're not going to stop them, and they're going to score some points. They're just too good. So we've got to score, you know, and take advantage of things that we can.
Coach, talk about this game and this week that is upon us now. Obviously, from last year, you have the tremendous run through the regular season, then an upset in that first round to Grand Island Central Catholic. Now this year, does the mindset change a little bit? What have you guys done differently to maybe try to prepare that maybe you felt like you didn't do last year that you wanted to get done this year, and how that might change what happens on Friday night?
Well, and our kids have talked about it, and we talked about, you know, it was a great regular season we had last year, but then, you know, we get beat right away, and if them kids could take that game back, they would. And we've really, really pushed that hard. Let's not have that happen again this year. Let's make sure we leave everything on the field, and you know, if Moon beats us, they beat us, but let's play our best game. If we do that and they beat us, there's nothing more we could have done. But we have got to come out, and we've got to give 100% effort every single play, and then, you know, see what happens, go from there.
Kickoff is at 7 o'clock there in Wilbur as the Wolverines host Boone Central Newman Grove. You can hear it on KUTT 99.5 as well. And we'll talk more about how I know you can hear that on KUTT coming up in just a little bit. That is Coach Lynn Juergens of Wilbur Claytonia. Coach, thanks so much for the time, and best of luck coming up on Friday.
Thank you guys for coming us. We really appreciate that.
All right, Tony, we are into our one final home stretch. And before we get too far, we do want to talk about how in the world did I know that that game was on the radio, 99.5. For those of you that have not been on the rest of strivesports.com, you will notice, if you are watching us not quite on full screen, the black banner about a third of the way down on your screen says FB Playoffs, if I'm not mistaken. It's somewhere off to my left as I'm looking up here. You can scroll, though, and go to our click the link, and it takes you to our playoff homepage. And from that homepage, you can find the links to the brackets, you can find links to kickoff times, and you can find links to what we've seen so far, and we would encourage any media outlets to pass information along to us if you have it, on webcasting or online stream for audio and for radio stations as well. We'd like that to be a really nice resource for anyone in the state, regardless of class, to be able to go on there and find out, hey, I want to listen to the top four games tonight. Who am I going to try to go back and forth between? There will be all of that information. So, again, if there's other media guys out there that we don't have your game and your station information listed, shoot us an email, shoot us a tweet, whatever you have, and we'll get that information on there. So, Tony, if we're not mistaken, first-round games for the six-man playoffs, the eight on Friday, of course, eight-man coming up tomorrow. So are you ready to make some picks for us today?
Let's do it. Are we going all the way through the bracket or just the first-round games?
Well, just the first round, I think.
Oh, come on. We got to – all right, that's fine.
How about we do first-round games, pick your state champ?
Okay, that sounds good to me.
Let's start with six man. Taylor's going to help us out and let us go through here. He's going to guide us through as we go through our playoffs here.
You guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yep.
Barely. All right, let's start in the six man playoffs on Friday, right?
Is that where yes, we're on Friday. Yep.
Hyannis versus Arthur County. 6 p.m.
You go first, Eric.
I'm going to take Hyannis in that. You can check it out on 99.7 The Lake.
Yep, I got the Longhorns too in the Big Back. Gabe Haney.
Yep.
All right, next up, Riverside Chargers with the number one seed versus Juanita Palisade at 4 p.m. in Cedar Rapids.
By the way, you can watch a lot of really good football and go from Cedar to Spalding to St. Ed, as they say it up there. I'm taking Riverside in that game. I'm taking Riverside in Kearney as well at the end of the season.
Yep, big Chargers.
Yeah. Yep.
That game should be streamed live.
Should be streamed. Yeah, that should be on the Riverside Strive channel, if I'm not mistaken. That with the six-man not under the NSAA banner for the playoffs, that should be on the Riverside Strive channel.
Spalding Academy versus Silver Lake.
I'm taking the Shamrocks in this one. That's a 4 o'clock kickoff there in Spalding.
Yep, this is going to be boring. I'm taking the Shamrocks, and we'll just move on down and give me the Beavers, too, in the next
Saint
game
Ed
as well.
Versus Wilcox Hildreth.
St. Ed, 7 o'clock kickoff at home. Tony, so we both said Riverside, I think, for the end of the season. Who you got playing Riverside?
I'm going to take St. Ed. I believe that the six-man coaches, after these first-round games, they'd re-bracket based on points, I think. So I don't know exactly if we're going to know exactly how this will shake out. But I will take Riverside and St. Ed in the finals.
Yeah, and they should play it. I think they should play it in Spalding. I mean, that'd be as close as anything through the middle of both. In any event, what's that?
Primrose?
We could play it in Primrose. Well, you know, we got some room on the farm.
Mm-hmm.
Grandpa Jim will make us a spot, I'm sure. DV. How about division? How about D2 on the East bracket?
Hey, how about I do this?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, you go. You
start D2 East bracket. St. Mary's at Humphrey St. Francis. Go.
Flyers. 6 o'clock kickoff on KRBX AM.
Osmond at Osceola at 7.
I'm taking Osceola on KKOT.
I think this is the best eight-man game of all of Thursday, one of the top three anyway. Osmond won 6 in a row, lost their last 2. I'm going to take Osceola just barely to set up that rematch of one of our games of the week from earlier this year.
Johnson Brock heading up to Randolph for a 3:30 kickoff.
Give me Johnson Brock. You can listen to it on B103 FM.
I'm going to be mean and not take the Strive School. Give me Randolph and their running back, Loberg, in that one.
Emerson Hubbard at Fall City Sacred Heart for a 3 o'clock kickoff.
Give me Sacred Heart in that one. NewsChannelNebraska.com has some information on that one.
Irish in a running clock game.
All right, Palmer at Why Not for a 5 o'clock kickoff.
This one's tough. JC is from Palmer. I've got some great friends from college that were all in my wedding are from Palmer. And I'm going to take Why Not.
Me too.
Lions of Decatur Northeast at Lawrence Nelson for a 4 o'clock kickoff.
Give me the Raiders.
Yeah, I'll take the Raiders as well in that one. Interesting second-round matchup there with Why Not and Lawrence Nelson. That'd be a good one.
Oh, yeah.
Giltner at Kennesaw for 7 o'clock kickoff.
I don't know if it's going to rain, but Giltner played their last game in the rain, and they did very well. So I will take Giltner at 5-3 over Kennesaw at 6-2. Kennesaw gave Extra Milligan, I know, all they wanted in week one.
Giltner played their last game in the rain to Lawrence Nelson, and they got beat. And I'm going to take Kennesaw with Preston Schnitzler. He was hurt the first 2 games of the year. They've rattled off 6 straight since then.
That game's on Power 99, by the way.
Sterling at Exeter Milligan, 6:30 kickoff.
In Milligan, I believe they will play that one, and I will take the Timberwolves.
Timberwolves big, and that second-round match is going to be good no matter who wins, Giltner and Kennesaw.
So
D2 West bracket. Sorry, Eric, we got to go.
Yeah, we
Wallace
do.
At CWC, 3 o'clock kickoff.
CWC.
How about I just give you all my winners in the West?
If you got them, Sam.
CWC, Brady, Stewart, Anselmo Myrna, Sandhill Stedsford, Maxwell, Crawford, and Garden County.
The only one I will be different, I will take Mullen over Stewart. Otherwise, I would agree.
All right, let's go to D1. East bracket, you guys want to do the same thing? Go ahead.
Same thing. I will take BDS. I will take Pender on the road. I will take Nebraska City Lords, Guardian Angels, East Butler High Plains. I'll take all the home teams except Neely Oakdale in the D1 East bracket.
Except Neely Oakdale. I will take Neely Oakdale, and I will just to be different. But otherwise, I will take all the home teams on the D1 East. Yes.
Oh, and Coach Walsh is going to be mad at you guys.
I know.
All right. Pender's coach is our Strive guy up there.
D1 I just
West.
Took Pender.
Oh, okay. Eric.
He's
going
to be mad
Eric
at me.
Did.
I know.
D1 West.
I will take Amherst, Arapahoe, Blue Hill, Burwell, Hemingford. I will take all the home teams in D1, but I'm gonna give Dundee County Stratton a shot against Clearwater Orchard. Yeah, I think that'll be another one of the top 8-man games tomorrow night.
Just to be different, I'll take the Tigers.
There you go.
Everyone else at home.
Boom. Don't have a radio link for that, so let us know if you got one.
If you got one, let us know.
Let's move up to C2.
All right, now we're just in no East and West anymore. Mm-hmm. In C2, you know what? As boring as this sounds, I'm going to take all the home teams in C2, and I really think the best one is a Strive School matchup between Crofton and UTAN. That should be a really good one. I'm going to take UTAN just barely. I think that one will be really good.
I wholeheartedly agree, and you're right, Tony. If there is a seeding upset, and I'll leave it at that, if there is one, it is Crofton over UTAN. So, but yeah, I will also take the home teams in C2.
All right, I'll run through these individually. We got some time here. O'Neill.
We picked up time.
O'Neill at Columbus SCOTUS.
Shamrocks, huge.
Yes.
Chase County at Ashland Greenwood, 4 o'clock kickoff.
That's Blue a Jays. Huge bus ride for Chase County, is it not?
342 miles.
There you go. Ashland Greenwood all the way.
Broken Bow heads to Central City, both 8-1, 7 o'clock kickoff.
The Bison.
Hip, hip, hooray, right? Yes.
All right, and I think we still have Coach on the line, so no pressure, guys. But Boone Central, Newman Grove at Wilbur, Claytonia. I will be at the game, 7 o'clock kickoff.
Go ahead, Tone.
Coach, you can chime in. You can hang up if you want to, Coach. That's okay.
You know, here's the deal. I will take Wilbur Claytonia and their defense. No pressure, Coach, but I like the defense in the playoffs. I think this is going to be – I circled three games in the 11-man ranks that I said I wish I could go to this game, and this was one of them. So that will be a really, really exciting one. I'm going to take the Wolverines in this one.
I am going to take the Cardinals because they've – no, this is funny, and I hope they listen to this and watch this. They got bulletin board material from my mother-in-law, all right, because I was up there last weekend, and she said, yeah, I was like, man, Boone's had a really good year. Well, they weren't as good this year as they were last year. Whoa, yeah, 7-2, lost to Norfolk Catholic and SCOTUS. Okay, so there's your bulletin board material. I'll take the Cards in the upset in the first round.
Syracuse at Boys Town.
Boys Town, really, really good. Yeah. You know what? I think this game's closer than you think, but I'm going to take Boys Town just barely.
I would agree, but I also will take Boys Town.
All right, Holdridge at Wahoo, both 7-2.
Wahoo has they've already played the playoffs, I think. I'm pretty sure, and have fared pretty well. So I'll take Wahoo in the first round.
Bishop Newman at Ogallala. Newman, 5 o'clock Mountain Time.
Yeah, 5 o'clock Mountain Time. Try figuring that one out. KOGA, 9:30 a.m. on your radio. Bishop Newman at Ogallala. Yeah, I'll take Newman as well.
All right, and Falls City at Norfolk Catholic, 2 o'clock kickoff.
I know Falls City is a Strive school, but Norfolk Catholic is, wow. I expect them to win the whole shooting match. Let's put it that way.
It's going to be a heck of a game. If someone beats Norfolk Catholic in the playoffs this year, it's going to be a fantastic game when they do it.
All right, let's go to Class B. Alliance heading to Aurora for a 2 o'clock Central Time kickoff.
2 o'clock Central in Aurora. I'll take the Huskies.
Huskies running clock.
All right, let's go to Scottsbluff at Gretna, 5 o'clock kickoff.
Gretna has also played the playoffs, I think, already on their season. Scottsbluff has, too. Boy, they've had a tough schedule. Tony, what do you got there?
This is a really good one. I'm going to take Gretna only because they're home.
I will agree for the exact same reason. And can I say that we've talked all year that Class B is so competitive. This has got to be my absolute favorite bracket of the entire state. Every single one of these games is going to be really good, I think.
I agree.
Sorry, I was editing your shot. Are we Beatrice at McCook?
That's where we're at, yes.
All right.
Bison,
yes.
Bennington at Plattsmouth.
Plattsmouth.
Ross DeJuris's dad, Bob, the Plattsmouth coach. Give me the Blue Devils to go to 10-0.
Does Bob have a mustache like Ross?
He's got a mustache. It ain't like Ross's.
All right. Sydney with the long trek to Elkhorn South. You know, last year all those Omaha schools were up talking about how much it cost them to travel. Haven't heard any of that talk from the Western Nebraska schools yet. Elkhorn 5 o'clock South. Kickoff.
Elkhorn South in a big way.
Yep. Ron Cauley at York.
Good. Love the Dukes good. In late October, early November. Yeah. I'll take the Dukes. And I think I even think like a 30-10 type game even too. I think the Dukes will control this one.
Cannons firing, Dukes win.
Yep.
Pius at Northwest. Tony will be there.
I will be there. This was one of the other three I circled. I am going to take the Vikings, and I'll give you want to give you the trivia here on this one. Grand Island coach Kevin Stein will be the second coach in the state to have played for his dad in the playoffs and coached his son in the playoff. His son, Peyton, the backup quarterback, sophomore for the Vikings. And the actual other combo is actually in the playoffs as well. Craig Schnitzler, the coach at Kennesaw, his son is Preston. He's coached a couple sons in the playoffs. He was a quarterback for his dad, Bob, at Battle Creek in the 1980s, and they played in the playoffs a few times. The Braves did. I'm taking the Vikings.
That's my pick. I am too. I've seen the Vikings a few times this year. Guy can't not row the boat, right? So
exactly.
Vikings winning.
Waverly at Scut.
Scut by 50.
Scut by a running clock.
Class A, Lincoln North Star at Bellevue West. I'm assuming the same.
I'm taking West in this one.
Also, me too.
Millard South at Norfolk.
If there's going to be an upset in A, I think this could be interesting. I just for the grins of it, I'll take Millard South in this one because I think in the A bracket, this one looks really good in the first round.
Not an upset. Millard South wins.
Ooh.
Kearney at Millard North, 4 o'clock kickoff.
North.
Millard North also.
North Platte at Omaha Central, 6 o'clock kickoff.
Omaha Central, this day, 20 years ago, Amon Green, first play against Colorado, 57-yard touchdown.
You're taking the Eagles, I take it?
Yes.
First 1-10 wins this game. North Platte had Grand Island on the ropes last week. I expect a low-scoring game, but I'm going to take the Eagles.
Omaha North at GI.
The Islanders have the best video production crew I've seen. I was so jacked up watching their playoff hype video, I wanted to go play. Give me the Islanders in round one.
How many times you played in the championship game? Islanders. And Omaha North have played classics in the semifinals the last 2 years, and they've gone the Vikings way, both of them. Omaha North is probably better than their record indicates, beat up a little bit this year. But I am going to take the Islanders close.
Papillion La Vista at Omaha Westside.
Westside. For me.
You know what? Give me – I'm going to be crazy here. Give me Randy Hubert and the Monarchs in an upset. I don't know why. Just a hunch.
Creighton Prep at La Vista South.
Give me South in this one. Didn't they just play not too long ago?
Rematch of last week, actually, when Creighton Prep upset them to really get in the playoffs or solidify their spot. I think, too, give me Papillion La Vista South. Remember, the Titans upset Millard North last year when they were undefeated in the quarterfinals. The great Hastings coach, Walt Olson, is the coach for Papillion La Vista South. I'm going to take South and Tristan Fairchild in this one.
North Lincoln Northeast at Millard West, 7:30 kickoff, by the way.
Yep, that's at Buell Stadium. What's the other one? Millard North hosting Kearney is the 4 o'clock game at Buell, and then Lincoln Northeast at Millard West in the 7:30 game. Millard West 9-0, number one in Class A. I've got the Wildcats winning that one and the rest of them all the way through Memorial Stadium.
Very interesting. I'm also going to take the Wildcats. I'm really interested to see how this A plays out. Here's what I'll give you as far as this goes. I'm going to say that we have an all Buell semifinal day with Millard North hosting Bellevue West and Millard West playing Grand Island. We'll see how these play out.
That should be a lot of fun. We have gone over our time though, Tony. We went through that as fast as we could. Oh, yeah, we're side by side. I should look this way. No other way. No, I can look at this way.
Which, is it like the Brady Bunch? Should I go like this or like
up,
this?
Up, down, like that? In any event, a huge thank you to our guests tonight. We had Burke Brown of Nebraska Prep Volleyball. We had Lynn Juergens of Wilbur Claytonia. We had Nate Klaus of HuskersOnline.com and Rivals.com and whatever else websites that that man does his homework for. And we also had Jim Clarkson of Clarkson Lee on the show tonight. Tony, the playoffs loom large. It should be a lot of fun to watch.
It should be a blast. Can't wait for tomorrow night. in Clark's. I'll be at High Plains and Owls Dodge.
I can't even remember where I'm going. I think I'm going to Milligan and then Shickley as well. So a little extra Milligan stuff and BDS as well. So looking forward to that coming
Fillmore
up.
County kid.
Fillmore County kid. I'll just go home and take Jackson trick-or-treating before that too. Thanks for watching us on Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com. Have a great Wednesday and enjoy your playoff games wherever you might be heading. Home-cooked favorites and online ordering so you can skip the line. That's what you'll find at Dickey's Barbecue in York. Log on to Dickey's.com, select the York address, sign in or create a profile, and you'll be ordering delicious barbecue in just seconds. Choose from a variety of meats like brisket, pulled pork, chicken breast, or sausage. Add a home-style side like waffle iron fries, fried onion tanglers, barbecue beans, and even fried okra. You won't go away hungry. Try Dickey's Barbecue today and log on to Dickey's.com. Kids eat free on Sunday.
Yeah, I get it. For the little things. Technology's great. It makes things easier. It's faster. We can get things done wherever we go. And we get all that from our bank. It works for us. But for the bigger things, the things that really count, I still want to talk to the people I know and trust. That's why I'm here.
Seedsmanship is what truly sets Channel Seed apart from other seed brands. It's our unmatched ability to provide you with the expert advice and customized service that helps you get the most yield out of your acres. It's the added value of year-round service combined with elite seed products that you only get from Channel Seed. At Channel, we know the importance of staying connected. As seed experts, we look to get the most out of your fields by putting ourselves in them throughout the season. That's seedsmanship at work.
I never really imagined that I would be a diesel technician. I started out in a whole different other field and then kind of worked my way and stumbled my way into it. And I enjoy every day of it.
The people that I work with are great. Even if you're having a bad day, you know, they find some way to try to make you laugh or smile, to try to brighten your day up. It'd be a life-changing opportunity. So there's a lot of good things that this company has to offer.